Okay, good morning, everybody. So, are you familiar with Nereid in the sense that you know what it does and what it's good for, what it's not the right thing for? Do you want me to start there, or do you want me to start with the workshop? How many of you want to know what Nereid is and where it can be used? All right. So, Nereid is a web framework. When I say web framework, quite close to what Django is or Flown is. There are a lot of web frameworks in the Python world. So Nereid is also a web framework on which you can build web applications. The difference is that Nereid's ORM or the data layer is powered by Tryton. So you get all the benefits of the Tryton ORM, you get all the features of the Tryton ORM, and you can put a web layer over it. So if you want to expose some set of the functionality, or if you want to build a app which does something specific like an e-commerce system or a customer portal or any of those special requirements where you don't want to give users access to your ERP, but at the same time you want this information, you want people to interact with you, that's where you use Nereid. So the design decisions that we have made is all based on these. So Nereid is again available on, the source code is available on GitHub. There are a lot of modules that we have built. There are new modules, like Zigzag Media is already writing a bunch of modules. So there are modules being contributed to. So we look forward to more contributions and more patches. So right now here, there's not much documentation available. So this tutorial, I've laid it out in a way. This was built in the last 4 hours, so you have to be, there could be issues. So I've separated building a module into 4 steps. So you can find the module on GitHub. So if you want to code along with me, you can clone the code. It's available on github.com/openlabs/nereid-tutorial. So where we start is with step 0. So this is a basic layout of, or a bare-bone Nereid module. A Nereid module is also a Tryton module. So as you can see, you have a init.py where you would just register your models, reports, anything that you have. You also have Tryton.cfg where you would put in your dependencies, your XML files, and so on. So if you want to depend on Nereid, all what you have to do is put up Nereid as a dependency here. You don't have to do anything else. If you have the usual setup.py script that you have, it automatically installs Nereid from PyPy. At the moment, Nereid is available for version 2.8. There's a path to migrate. We are migrating it to 3.0. I think that'll be done once the sprints are over. So you can start by just cloning the module to a new virtual end and start and running setup.py. So I've set up an empty server. I'll take you through the same steps. Can everyone see it back?
Yeah, sure not.
Okay. How am I going to do that? Anybody knows how to make the font higher? Okay. That's better. Can you see now? Great. So, I'm starting with a new virtual end. So it is. I kept my promise, everything is from scratch. Okay, finally. Okay, I hope everybody uses virtual lens for development. And I'm cloning the module. Okay, and please make sure that you are on, if you are coding along with me, please make sure you're on step zero. So you can see the list of files here. You have a setup.py, a pretty bare bones, same kind of setup file that you would find in any Tryton module. Running Python setup.py install should install this module. It should also download the latest version of Tryton 2.8 from the 2.8 series and install all the modules required. Who's coding along? Anybody who's coding along? While this gets installed, let's have a quick look at the code. This step itself doesn't have any Nereid specific code other than just the depends, which is there here. You specify that Nereid is a dependency. And also through this tutorial, I'd like to show you the what we think is the best practice to develop the modules. So it's a completely test-driven development in this case. So you can see as we go to step four, we have a complete test suite which covers all the features that we need. Okay. Okay, let's build a tryton.conf. Don't do this in production. Okay, so we finally have a Tryton server running. We can connect to it from calling my database tutorial, and Okay, so the database is being created. Okay, so the Nereid module for this specific case that we built, it's called Nereid under tutorial. So you can find the module here, mark the module for installation, and okay, that's going to take some time now. It has a country module to install, so that takes its own time. So meantime, let's move on to step one. So what we have in addition in step one and what it does now. Okay, so step one adds a application.py script into the package. So this is a standard. Can everyone see this code, or can you open on your machine? Okay, so if you are familiar with Python's WSGI, which is Web Service Gateway Interface, you are required to write a Python module like this, which returns a application object, which is a WSGI object for serving web applications. So Python itself gives you a lot of other tools like Unicorn, MicroWSGI, which allows you to serve this in very different ways if you have an application. So this is the recommended way to write web applications in Python, and this is how you would write a WSGI script for Nereid. So first you just have to import Nereid from the Nereid package, and then you build a dictionary with the configuration. So remember that each Nereid application is tied to a specific database. So unlike Tryton daemon itself, which connects to any database depending on how you specify, you cannot do that with Nereid, because when you type in a URL, you expect to see it connected to a specific, you expect to get results. It's phrasing a user, not an internal user who would know which database to choose. So each Nereid application is tied to a specific database, which is what you see there. Static file route, that is if you are going to serve static files, where you should expect to find the static files. It's a relative path from this application script. If you want to change the directory, you can put a full path to it, picks it up from there. Then you have a Tryton config. So you have to specify the Tryton configuration file, which needs to be loaded by Nereid for it to work. So that's from where it picks up all the SMTP settings, it, all the other related database settings, everything is picked up from there. You don't have to specify it again. And there's a extra parameter debug, which can be true or false. If you are in debug mode, any error that happens, you get to see the full stack trace, and you can debug it from the window itself. You can type in, you can introspect into the values of variables. It's a feature from Flask, you get the same thing here. And you have a template loader class and a template search path. So you can specify how you want to load your templates. Now, if you're writing a really big e-commerce application which scales over multiple systems, you might not want to use a file system. Store your templates on the file system. Maybe you want to put it in a Memcache server or something like that. So if you want to do that, or if you want to store it in Redis, you have all the options to do that. So you have multiple template loaders. You also have a Tryton template loader where you can put the templates into a Tryton model and it will load from there. So to initialize the application, you just initialize the Nereid class, assign it to app. It itself is a WSGI object, and you can update the configuration with the dictionary that you just built. Initialize, when you hit initialize, it loads the Tryton backend, initializes the pool, gets all the URLs, everything that needs to be handled, and it creates, it's a complete application object which is created there. So the last step is, if you're running this from the Python command line, what do you expect to see? That's why we run it in a debug mode to see what's going on. So it's a test runner. You should not use that in production. You should be using something like Unicorn. So this is just for testing. The last step is just for testing. Okay, I think finally our module is installed. Let's do some configuration. So I should have said this before. What we're trying to build here is a customer, kind of customer portal. So what we're going to do is display a list of products that's there in the system, display a list of once a user logs in, probably a list of sales that the customer purchase. So it's a very simple portal kind of system. You can call it a web shop if you want, a bare-bone web shop. Okay.
You said something about Flask. It was installed as a dependency of Nereid.
Yes, that's
okay.
Right. So Nereid is built over Flask.
Mm-hmm.
So Flask is a dependency. Creating a new company, standard stuff. Okay, so since I had sale as a dependency of the module, it installed everything related to it. So finished start, create the startup accounts, and we're done. Okay, so when you open the Nereid section on the Nereid menu on Tryton, you get these options, and most of the configuration of Nereid is done on the website itself. So what you have to do is to create a new website. You can have multiple websites inside your same database. So you can have an e-commerce system, you can have a wiki, you can have a blog, you can have multiple e-commerce sites itself which are completely independent. You can serve multiple sites from the same database. So you have to create each of these, and the name happens to be the same domain on which you domain you want to serve the site on. So in this case, it's tub.openlabs.us where we would be serving the site from. URL map, by default there's one URL map which comes in. You can have additional URL maps. It's a way to make sure if you have a blog and you don't want any of the other URLs to be served, you can create a separate URL map. So it's advanced functionality, I would put it. So let's choose English as our language. Application user, for now I'm choosing admin. So when you run, yesterday there was someone asking me about the security in Nereid. So when you run this application, the web application, all the requests are executed in a user context of the application user. So if you specify admin, the web app has all the access rights of admin. So you shouldn't be doing that in production. Though there are no privilege escalations, you shouldn't be doing that in production. You should be creating a separate user who has just the required access. Like if you have an e-commerce, if you're building an e-commerce system, that user should just have create rights to probably sale, the accounts, invoice, just those sale groups are what you would normally do. So this is the user context in which it's run. Nereid also defines a separate user object. It has its own access layer. So this is where you would create such a Nereid user. So usually this happens when the user registers, but for the first time you have to create a guest user. Now when since this is a web application, it can be accessed even without login. So when the user is not logged in, this would be the user that is used. So if you're going to access who is the current user, if the user has not logged in yet, this is the user you get. Okay, and that's it. We have our first website created. Now it's time to move on to the step two, that is upgrade the module to with the application.py, and when you run it, you should be able to see the website. So let's try that. Step one. So this is the updated version with the application.py. Let's run python setup.py install. Okay. So as we saw before, the python application.py script, it's run in debug mode, so it has an automatic reloader. So if you're writing code and if you change your code, the code is automatically reloaded. So it's very easy for developers to work on this. Okay. So that's our first web application. So this was a page which was which is available inside the module that we built. let's have a look at this page where it gets served from. So templates, home.jinja, which kind of extends the templating language used inside Nereid is Jinja 2, which is kind of the most popular and probably the fastest templating system that's there in Python. So if you have, you can, and it's very well documented as well, so whatever you want to do, it's probably one of the best frameworks out there. And the page got the home page. These are URL handlers which are already there in core of Nereid, so you didn't have to define anything special to get access to this. So you have your first page getting served from here. Was it simple? Did I lose all of you, or are you still in? Is it? Are you getting it? Or
by the way, you say you need to define every web page you're going to use or expose with Nereid. And did you do that in the background while installing the step one module, or
this homepage? Are you talking about the homepage which is exposed?
Yeah.
Yeah, the homepage gets served from core of Nereid. Every module that's installed, like if you remember, we put Nereid as a dependency of this module. So if you look at the code of core Nereid, so this is where it gets rendered from. So there's this URL handler. Okay, that was not something what I wanted to see. Okay, so griff home. This is the method to which the dispatcher went in. And it says just return render template, which is the shorthand to render a template. You provide a template name, and if you want any additional arguments to be passed, you can pass those arguments here. Now, in most cases, I think most of the work we have done, the homepage always just remains kind of a static homepage from where you get the rest of the functionality. So it's almost always you just modify the template and everything else comes for you automatically. But in some cases, maybe you want to list your like in the e-commerce system, if you're building an e-commerce system, the homepage has a lot of functionality. It's going to show you the most featured products, the trending products, and all of this. All what you have to do is, like a regular Tryton module, in your custom module, inherit Nereid.website, replace the class method with a new class method, and the new functionality that's picked up by the dispatcher instead of this one. So it's if you have a class website with the under name Nereid website and you replace that method, your new method takes effect. So if you look at the Nereid webshop modules, it replaces the home page completely to put in all the trending products, the recently looked up products that you did, all that extra arguments are passed on. Now it's quite common that you want to change just a specific behavior of the parent model. That's possible too, because the render template, what it returns is an object. It's not a string, it's an object, and you can still modify the context and you can change the values there, you can add values there, you can even change your template what needs to be rendered. You can do that. Did I lose you?
Yeah, more or less. Anyway, I guess that, for example, that method definition should be the controller.
That's right.
So you define the web pages in the Tryton configuration. So how do I link the pages I have defined in Tryton to that controller?
That's step two. You came into the right question. Okay, so let's have a look at how that is done. So when we move into step two, what's going to happen is we get...
Wait. Just one last question. I still don't have really clear in my mind how do you manage the from user management perspective with Nereid. You say you define a user in the web pages configuration. So I guess for providing context to the controller, I can use a different user for each web page.
Yes, you can.
For example?
Yeah.
For example, if I have an eShop or maybe a user portal in the same group page, I can use one user for the user portal and another one for the e-commerce shop.
You can. You all what you have to do is change the transaction dot set user, and you're done.
Okay.
So how did the URL? How do you tie the URL pattern that you have to a specific method? That was your question. So, let's have a look at that. URLs are stored in the database, and they are created like when you create the modules. It's usually created in a XML file. So, the convention that we have followed so far, the file is always called urls.xml, and this is a record that you would create for the Nereid URL rule. Okay, so you have the URL, and you specify that if the URL pattern is language, ENUS, whatever that is, language slash products, then point to product.product.renderList. So this is the model, and this is the method name. So it calls product, it loads the model product, and calls the render list there. So let me show you that from... routing URL rules. So all the rules that we have are, you can see them here and where they dispatch to. So these are all these URLs you see here are from the core module itself. So for example, the home page, which is just a forward slash, it points to Nereid website home. So this is how you tie it together. Is it making sense? Did I lose you, or should I explain once again how it works?
That's the way it works. You can pack in a module all the functionality, but you can spread overloading other models, for example, to make your computations and generate the results to provide the template context, for example.
That's right. So other modules, since this is all written in XML, you can modify an existing handler too. Like if a downstream module wants to change that the forward slash should not point to Nereid website home, instead it should point to foo.bar, a downstream module can just replace the URL and this would get replaced. And these are ordered by a specific sequence and they are loaded in this order as well. So you can change the sequence and even that could change how the URL pattern behaves. So all the URLs are here. You can find out from here where it points to. So this is a very pretty simple pattern. The last part after the dot is the method name, and the remaining of it is the model name. So in the case of if it's product.product and you have a method called renderList, what you would do is call product.product.renderList here. And you can create them using XML.
But I don't see the relation between the XML and that configuration I'm seeing in the screen.
If you see the first one here, it's a forward slash, the rule says forward slash, and endpoint is Nereid website home. So let's go to the Nereid code. And Nereid code also has a urls.xml where all this, how a URL should tie to the method is done. And this is the handler which you just saw. So it says it has a unique ID, which is standard Tryton. When you define any XML record, this is what you do. You say the rule, it's forward slash. Endpoint is nereid.website.home. Sequence allows you to order the whole thing. And which are the methods allowed? So in this, it says that the home page, only get method is allowed. You can get, post, put, it's REST compatible. So you can say which of these methods are allowed. So if you try a post method on this, it automatically returns a 403 without you doing anything. And finally, it attaches this URL to this URL map. So URL map is like a group of URLs. So you can create a separate group if you want to build a totally different application if you want to.
But does this XML get generated through the user interface in Tryton?
No, it has to be handwritten. I think everybody who has written a Tryton module is should already be familiar with this, because this is how you create views, this is how you create any record inside Tryton, so it's pretty common. Okay, so let's switch to step 2. Okay, in this case, this is where the new urls.xml got added. So in addition to running python setup.py install, you should also upgrade the Tryton database so that the new URLs get registered. So let me do that. Are you able to see it back there? I can do it from here, or I can just call the upgrade module functionality from the Tryton user interface. I don't have to come back here, but this is faster. So run application py again, and when you go back here, now the link, there's a subtle change. There's an additional products handler. So when you click on products, it's supposed to show you a list of products. It's obviously there are no products in the database at the moment. So let's create some products here and let's see how this handler works. I'm going to create two products. One is a saleable product, because we have a domain expression there to demonstrate that. Let's say a list price of 10, cost price of 20. Okay, so we have a saleable product, we have a not so saleable product. Okay, save, back to this, refresh, we should have our saleable product here. So how did that happen? So let's have a look at the code again. So this is the specific URL handler, and let's have a look at the thing here. Slash, let's ignore the first part, and slash ENUS slash products. So here we have specified slash language slash products. If that's the URL, point to product.product.renderList. So we go back to Nereid, to the product.py. Inside product.py, I've just extended product.product in the standard way, a standard writing way. A method in there called render underscore list. All what it does is it searches for all the products that's there with saleable equal to true. It renders a template products.html. We'll see the template now. And it passes the products that it got into the context. So, was that clear? Should I? Okay, I think it's. Okay. Is it visible now? Yeah. So, the dispatcher calls render list. Inside render list, you are searching for all the products that is there, find which are saleable is equal to true, gets a list of the products. It returns a render template, which is pick up this template from the templates folder and render that with this context. And in the context, you can provide as many variables as you want inside the context. So here it says provide a variable inside the template called products, which has the products that you just received as the context. So let's have a look at how the template is written for this.
There's only one method, only render template.
That's it. Templates, products.html, again, very simple. It extends base.ginger, so it's a extend the other one. And inside the body, create a new table. This is a heading, simple HTML. For product and products, because it's a list of active records that you get. So for product and products, the first one is loop.index, which is a internal Jinja built-in. which gives you 1, 2, 3, 4 each time you iterate over it, and display the product.code, product.name, product.listPrice, and what you get is this. So it's displays the count, change here. This is the saleable product. The other one did not appear. So any changes that you make, they appear instantly. Like, for example, if you're going to create a code here, it's done, instant, the changes are done. No synchronization, no sending data, no locks, no mutexes.
And what happens if you add multiple product variants to one product?
No problem at all. It displays that, and Nereid comes in with a built-in paginator. So you can just pass on the domain, the search domain, pass on the page, pass on the number of items per page, and it automatically paginates this in the query itself. So it's not like pull up everything and then paginate. No, it's the search query itself is paginated. So it provides you an API for that. And our largest implementation had 4 million products, so it successfully paginated that many, so it should work. Okay, and all of these features, functionality, everything is fully tested.
So did you say that you tried Nereid with a 4 million products database?
That's right.
And no issues, no problems, no hands from the server, no nothing.
People.
Oh my god.
Of course, some things just would break, like search, because it would take forever to search. So we replaced it with Elasticsearch. That module is also available publicly. You can use it.
Elasticsearch.
It's a full-text search engine based on Lucy. So you can connect Tryton with that. It's not just with Nereid. It works with any Tryton model, any Tryton object. And you can use full-text search on that. And it works with multiple languages. And we also use the same thing for faceting, which is also known as layered navigation. If people are familiar with Magento or PrestaShop, it's called layered navigation. So you search for something and you get it segmented by price range or category, how many are there in the category. So that left kind of navigation, what you get the same thing. So was that clear?
And where do you have that module, you say?
Everything on GitHub.
On GitHub.
Yeah, you can go to
Open
Labs. Yeah, GitHub / Open Labs, and you should find everything there. Okay, so everybody clear? Can I go to the next step? All right. So next step is a little leap forward. What we're going to build are login and registration in one go. So when you do registration, I'm sure we're all familiar, once you register, you expect to get an email which says you registered. So for that, we need to send emails. To send emails, we use the same get SMTP server functionality that Tryton provides. But for that to work, we need a Tryton configuration to do that. So I'm going to just steal the configuration from another server. Okay. So this is not going to send any emails. It's going to be stored in Mailtrap. Mailtrap is a web service which allows you to test SMTP. So you send out an email, it doesn't send the email, it stores a copy in itself, and you can see what the email was. It's very good to debug emails if you want to debug how emails work. Git checkout step 4. It's step 3. Zero based index. For a change, for this change, I'm going to upgrade the database from from the modules list. Okay, the module is updated. Python application.py. Seems to be working. And now you have a login section. So you can, it's a pretty simple login form. You don't have to implement any additional functionality, no Python code whatsoever to do login, registration, reset, nothing. All what you have to do is design HTML, because authentication comes as a core feature in Nereid. So you just have to put in the HTML. It should just work. So let's register. I'm going to register as Albert. Albert Atlantic. I know your password too.
It's half an hour.
Okay. Okay, so we just registered. It's supposed to show you a pop-up message saying, hey, your registration was successful, an email has been sent. That's the JavaScript part. You get something called flash messages along with this. So flash message feature is also included, but I haven't put it into the HTML to see. You can check out one of the example web shops that's there on GitHub for Nereid, and you can find the code there. So let's have a look at mail trap. I should have got a new email right now. Yeah, there we go, Albert at Nantic. And to activate your account, click here. Now, this template is also part of the templates folder. Let's go to step 3. Emails and activation HTML, activation text. So it sends a text part and a HTML part. So you can modify. This is a pretty simple thing. So you can modify it with all your graphics, whatever you want to put in. You want to make it a very beautiful activation email, you can do that with all your tracking, whatever you want, all in HTML. Okay, so since I have the registration link, let's activate the account.
So the mail generation and the email confirmation, it's already built in Nereid.
It's already built in Nereid. And you also have social authentication, Facebook, Twitter, Google, LinkedIn, and GitHub. Okay, it's not supposed to take that long. I think it's because it's Albert's email. Okay, so your activation is done too, and Albert is logged in. So you can see, log in there. You can log out and log back in again. All this is simple template code, like, let me show you how that login thing works. Okay, in the base.jinja, this is the code you need to look at for how the login thing switches. So there's a request, is the current request which came in. So if request.isGuestUser, which is a property, if the user is guest, then display this, which is a login, and says nereid.website.login when you click on that. Or if the user is logged in, display this. So with a simple if else, it handles all the logged in part, what you want to show to the user. Similar to this, we also have a has permission. So if you want to just write if request.nereiduser.hasPermission to see sale orders, display this. If not, you can hide that. So it comes along with the permissions and access layer too. You can use that. And if you want to see how the login page works, same, extends the base.jinja. You just have a simple form with all the eye candy, and it calls a render field. Render field is a kind of macro which creates a bootstrap. It's also written inside the template itself. It's a macro which generates some code for the bootstrap widget. That's all. It's the same thing. I'll show you that code as well, because you can put in a what icon to put in. It's a helper which comes in, but what's a placeholder that you want to fill it in, all that, and it renders a corresponding field. It's a simple form, ends here. The post, it goes to, the action is specified as nereid.website.login. So it sends a post request to login. That's it. The job is done. Now, if you want to move, as soon as the user is logged in, you want him to redirect to a different page, or the user tried a page which requires access rights. When the login page comes in, there would be a next on the URL. He gets redirected to the page that he wanted to visit. So
the template for other kinds of forms is going to be built this same way.
That's right. So this render field came in from helpers.jinja. Mm-hmm. So if you want to have a look at how that is there, this is how it looks. It just creates a form group. It says if there's a label, display the label. Mm-hmm. If you want to hide the label. So it's a kind of helper which renders a field for you in a pretty way.
And can you show us how does the Python code receives the values that the form has sent, the post method has sent?
Sure. Okay, so let's have a look at the login form, because that should be the easiest thing to understand. Mm-hmm. So it's in it's in website. Diff login. Okay, there we go. So it says login form is equal to login form of request.form, and login form is a predefined form object. We use WT forms for this. So you can just say email, it's a text field, validators, it's a required field, validators.email, and password is a password field, validators.required. Mm-hmm. That's it. And when the form is called, it validates the form and then proceeds. So here it checks if the method is post, then authenticate the user, and based on that, set the session, return it. Pretty simple stuff. If you want to have a look at the registration and how it sent out the email, you can have a look at that too. Okay, this is a registration method, very small, just this much code. So it has a similar registration form. It validates the form. It checks if it's an existing user. If it's an existing user, it flashes the message, the registration already exists with this email, please contact customer care, whatever that is you want. And party, if the user is not there, it creates a party, it creates a Nereid user object, and saves it, creates an activation code, sends an email, and says registration complete, check your email for activation, job done. So all the base code is already done. Questions?
May we see the top of the file? The top of this file?
Top?
Yeah.
Sure. Ah, okay. The translations here?
Yes.
Okay, so this is...
The flash message?
Yeah, there's a bunch of code which needs to be made translatable strings. So you can make a translatable string by using the same underscore syntax, the standard Python way of writing translatable strings. And you can have it. Also, it works with Babel, so even the template, everything is translatable to the language you want. So, since some of this development was funded by a Brazilian customer, we have some Brazilian Portuguese translations and some Spanish translations for some of the modules, but not everything is translated. So these strings can be extracted out of it, and it creates PO files.
He asked why you used getText style instead of Triton's style of translation.
Because the Triton ones depend on the database, and it pulls up from the database, so each time the template is rendered, it's going to create a request to the database, while in this case, this is going to be handled from the file system, loaded in memory, and it's handled from memory by getText.
But I think there is a problem with using getText in Triton, with inheritance. That's why it uses the current system. Maybe Cedric could.
Cedric? Why do we not use gettext inside Tryton? Why do we have a separate translation system? The standard PO files and the gettext functionality from offered by standard Python lib.
Are you talking about the database?
The question is, why don't we use the underscore parenthesis string parenthesis? I think there is a technical problem which cannot be addressed with the Nereid times and all this stuff. I remember that there was a technical problem behind not just the sorting of the PO file, because we could sort that with the script. I can't remember exactly the details, but with inheritance, you have some problems to know which string you're talking about when trying to translate. That's not the problem, because we could use the X get text functionality to extract the text and then make the underscore function act override that function and work whatever we want.
Yeah, but then you are in this string machine and the procession Tryton is not about string but about exactly
the place. That was the problem.
The level of this field or this error message, and it's really
The problem was that if you have the same string in the code three times, you cannot know which one is being called with gettext. So you just have a dictionary with old password, which has to be converted to something else. So when a word has different meanings, you have different translations, you don't know which one you're referring to.
I'm not so sure about that, because I think the PO database stores along with the line number.
Well, I don't think it uses the line.
But it's not used maybe for loading later. So and there's no way.
Let me just have a.
It's used just for information, probably. If the same word is there three times, it will show you in the comments of the dictionary entry. It will say this word is in three places. But you cannot have three translations for the same term in different places, okay? Because it cannot know the...
Let's have a look at that. I think it does store...
It would add this... The same message would be only there only once. Exactly, that's the case.
Okay, so that's the problem. And if you add the inheritance thing here, because you can add comments in the original text.
Yeah.
To be translated.
Yeah.
But with inheritance, this is complex. You cannot ensure that you disambiguate all cases. You know what I mean?
I do, but I don't think it's a problem because the translation here in this case, I'm not sure about it, but I've not seen the problem myself. It's stored locally in the sense that it's in the same folder of the template that is of the Python code, and it's picked up locally. So I think I'm not sure how getText checks the xgetText checks the line number, or if it's uGetText really checks the line number. I'm not sure about it. How does Tryton extract the strings, translatable strings, and put them into the?
It doesn't extract them from the structure because it's in the object. The strings are linked to one object somewhere. Strings with the model, the records, the results, strings with the buttons. So we just look at inside the pool.
Yeah, I think we could implement that. We could try and implement that. The string extraction is anyway done by the Babel API, so it should be pretty easy to change it to work with the Tryton database. Instead of fetching from xgetText locally, you can fetch it from the Tryton database. And that should work. You should try.
Yeah.
Other questions?
Session handling, cookie handling is made by Flask.
It's handled by Flask.
Okay.
So if you are if your application is a one server application, we can use the file system session cache.
Mm-hmm.
So it stores into any folder that you provide. Or if you're going to have a multi-server installation, like if you're going to scale out,
okay,
you can use Redis or you can use Memcache.
Memcache, okay.
Yeah,
and the cache configuration you would put on Flask configuration.
You would put it in the application.py.
On the application.py, okay.
Yeah, like here, in step 4, once we introduce the login, you require a session. So it uses a file system session. So that's added here. It's just one step, app.session interface.session store, file system store, store it into TMP.
Okay.
So instead of that, you can fetch from near Redis store or Memcache. So it's a unified API.
Mm-hmm.
So it also comes with a cache, which also works with a unified API. You can use Memcache, you can use any caching system that's out there.
Is the transaction, is the database transaction management integrated? Is it there as a middleware type component?
Yes. It's the database transaction. Each request is started in a new transaction,
yeah,
and if there are no error 500s, it's completely committed. If there are any error 500s, it's rollback and it's send back. So, it's
and there's a manual rollback for the conditions.
It's an automatic rollback. So,
okay.
Does that answer the question? No.
Yeah.
Well, I have another question about Tryton 3.0. You said that you were working on it. There are many big differences. What are the main issues to make it compatible?
There's already a patch for it. He has already migrated
it
to 3.0.
It's only a few lines because the Python version 3 work Python SQL.
Okay.
And we need to change the database and set context and three lines only.
Okay.
I think it's a small change, but for some reason the build is breaking, so the pull request is broken. So I think we'll be fixing it in tomorrow's sprint.
Okay.
More questions? Okay, so let's have a truth test. Do you think you'll be able to build Nereid modules?
I hope so.
We can try.
we can try. I think it's simple. We hang out on the IRC, so if you want.
The thing for me, for being the first time seeing Nereid's face, for example, in my case, I think you really need some time to go and code something to really realize how everything is tied together, how everything works. For example, I don't really know how, from the explanation, how really Nereid manages the two user interface layer, for example. How is it managing the users that are registering in your page? For example, you can manage them as parties. And the Nereid user module may, I don't know, it's something that it's not really clear for me. I think that maybe it really needed to code something and realize what is happening inside.
I think I should explain that. Whenever you register, it creates a Nereid user. So a Nereid user, the most of the information of the Nereid user is stored in the party itself. Just the username and password is here. So the rest of the information is associated to a party. So this was the Albert's username that we created an account when we registered. This is what it created. So when you install additional modules like social auth, with Twitter or Facebook or anything, it adds the extra information here connecting the handlers, or if there are API keys, they get attached over here, and this is where you handle the permissions as well. So,
but what
separate
permissions are you handling there?
Here, these are just
or
these are just text-based permissions. This is just for you to handle at the template layer, or you want to check if there's some specific permission that this user has. That's all. All the data access layer is still controlled by the Tryton user. So, when the transaction begins, when a request comes in, that transaction is run as the application user we defined in the web app. So the security is handled there. The rest of it, authentication itself, is done by this. If your application wants to throw this away completely, you can do that too. Like for the POS module that was developed, it makes no sense to have a separate Nereid user to use the POS from the iPad. You want to use the same Tryton user to do that. For that, all what you got to do is we built a decorator, a Python decorator. So here it says basic auth required. Let me show you the code of this is another handler which will give you the list of products back. So to get the list of products back, we have just put another decorator which says that basic auth is required, and this authentication is handled by the Tryton code. So inside helpers you have basic auth required. All what it does is it looks at the request if there's an authorization code inside, which is a username and base64 encoded password, and it uses the Tryton authentication REST user. It calls the authenticate method, the get login. If there is no such user, it creates unauthorized, sends it back, or if the user is there, it sets that user who logged in as the current user. So there, the POS app doesn't use Nereid users at all. It just does not require it. So authentication is optional. You want to build your own authentication layer, feel free to plug in.
So you were saying that the permissions for the Nereid user are provided to the template context.
That's right.
Okay. And how does it provide it to the template context?
Anywhere in the template you can access a context variable called request, which gives a current request. Inside the request you get additional arguments. One is the Nereid website, which gives a current website. Inside that, there's also Nereid user. So you can check Nereid user. You can call any method of Nereid user. It's request.Nereid user is a active record of the user object. So you can check any field name there, or you can call methods there. You can call class methods, instance methods, anything you want. So there, in that case, it would be an instance method which has permission, pass on the permission name, it returns true or false. We had a question.
Could you comment the eShop demo, just to Can you mention the main components of it?
We have a hosted demo. I think this is a URL. Oh, there we go. So this is based on 2.6. We had two demo stores before, and we could not make them public because both used templates and HTML code which were from a theme forest, the site. So that does not allow you to redistribute the code. So at the moment, there's this public GitHub repository which is called Nereid Web Shop, which is going to come with a default Bootstrap-based template. So this Bootstrap-based template has a very permissive license. So it's okay to redistribute it. You can use it too. So it would be like Magento. When you download, run it, it runs a full-fledged e-commerce system completely. You don't have to write your own templates. You just have to modify if you want to modify. So this is, we could not publish this template as well for the same reasons. So this time we are a bit careful on the license. So we can see the product here. Oops. Okay. This is a variance implementation. So if the same game is available for multiple platforms, you can choose, I would say copy it from Amazon. And same kind of store information. You can add the product to the cart. I hope it works. You can write full HTML descriptions. You can find, there's also, if you install the Nereid catalog module, which is what powers this one, you get, in addition to the categories implementation, you get something called browse nodes. The browse nodes idea is also an Amazon implementation. It allows you to relate one product to multiple categories across multiple hierarchies. So you don't have to be, one product need not just be available on one category. Like Tryton has a limitation that you can only put one category against a product because there are accounting rules which I use. So in this case, just for classification, we have browse nodes. So yeah, this is how it works. You can sign in and the Facebook thing works. This is just a old dummy store that's put up.
About
how to say it.
How to say it.
Huh?
About the roadmap to Nereid to Incore of Tryton. Because the last year talked about to enter a year ago.
Okay,
what is the roadmap? Is interesting, not interesting? What's your point of view? Is it?
Yes. I think you should be here. About merging Nereid with Tryton code, like a couple of things which makes me, it takes a lot of effort to put in anything into Tryton core modules because it requires significant effort of working with Cedric, going through separate iterations. No, that's what keeps the quality of the code, but and the module, that's what makes Tryton what it is, but it takes a lot of time to go through that process, so which is something which we haven't had time yet, and there are a few things which we would like to break. I feel that people, once they start using Tryton and the core modules of Tryton, at least when we write Tryton modules, we know for sure that in the next version, if there's something which changed, we know that there's a migration path and it works for sure. So I feel in the case of Nereid, we still have some things which need tremendous improvement. If you see the number of commits which happen, that's also very fast and very high, very frequent releases. So maybe, I don't know, if we should wait for some time before it goes in. What's your opinion, Cedric? All your original list of issues, we have fixed all of them.
But I think we should start with just the small part of the web server.
I think a big design philosophy difference between me and Cedric on this is I look at Nereid as a full stack framework, because if it comes with an ORM, it is supposed to come with a lot of other features, but that goes pretty much against the rest of it, where we think each of them should be separate modules. So I'm sure if Cedric looks at the code, he might say that Nereid is 5 modules, it has to be separated into 5. So that's a difference we have.
Yeah, I think we should start.
Yeah. Sure. I think once we move to 3.0, which is tomorrow, I will send a code review. You can butcher the code. Any more questions?
There are guides on how to write the Nereid modules, which are good integrate into Nereid and Python philosophy in the question of modularity. Is there any guideline on Nereid to write the Nereid modules which integrate good into the modularity of Tryton and to write modular Nereid?
There is no guideline, but it uses most of the it's the same idioms of Tryton that we use, so there's nothing as such which requires significant change. But one thing is templates, like if it's a shopping cart, we want to bundle the templates. Right now that we have the license issue sorted out, you might want to bundle your templates along with that. So just like how you would attach XML files, you can attach those templates. And the template search, how it finds a template is probably the only thing which you have to be careful about.
So install a module and it will have a default view for, and it will show me the that's nice.
Yeah. So you can have the templates are looked up in a pretty interesting fashion. If you have a local template folder with the final application.py, it first looks for the template there. If it doesn't find the template there, it will start looking through the Tryton module graph. So depending on how the module dependencies are, it looks at the most the outermost module first, and then it goes up all the way to find the module. So if you have a downstream module which implements an additional functionality, which it wants to replace the previous template, you can bundle the template along with that, and that would be picked up if that module is installed. So it looks at the Tryton module graph to pick up the templates as well. I think that's that makes it modular.